Okay, now, in a way, Hamlet is a good test of the premise of this course, and that is that consideration of political questions can help us understand Shakespeare. There are many people who have discussed Hamlet in terms of politics, but there's also a tendency among many critics to ignore the political aspects of the play. Hamlet seems like such a lonely, isolated, tortured individual that it's easy to abstract him from the political world. Some would even argue that he himself is abstracted from the political world. I think the play makes a lot more sense when you view it in political terms. And as I was trying to show last time, Hamlet himself is really quite political. He is very much concerned about the kingship. He actually would like to be king of Denmark. In fact, claims that he is king of Denmark in Act 5. And the play is shadowed by political issues all the way through, so that at the very end, on page 144, Fortinbras, in his very last speech, chooses to make a political judgment on Hamlet. This is Act 5, Scene 2, about line 397. Let four captains bear Hamlet like a soldier to the stage, for he was likely, had he been put on, to have proved most royal. The play actually ends with Fortinbras claiming Hamlet would have made a good king. Now, that's a very dubious claim, and in a way we've been spending time and will continue to spend time questioning that claim. And indeed, by now, we know to be very suspicious of the last speech in any Shakespeare play tragedy. It's usually made by the most highly ranked person left standing, and it does appear that Fortinbras may well be the next king of Denmark here, according to Hamlet's election. As we saw with Mark Antony and Brutus, or Ophidius with Coriolanus, or Antony and Cleopatra in regard to Octavius, Fortinbras has good reason to praise Hamlet here. Thanks to Hamlet, he's in line to become the next king of Denmark. It's very easy for Fortinbras to praise Hamlet. We've seen many times the last speech in the play is made by the guy who's defeated the fallen hero, or hero and heroine in the case of Antony and Cleopatra, and then chooses to praise them for a kind of political advantage. So anyway, if Fortinbras raises this issue at the end, I think we need to raise it. And indeed, the mere fact that Fortinbras is raising it calls into question the very claim Fortinbras makes here. How good a king would Hamlet have made if he chooses a Norwegian as the next king of Denmark? This is a very striking development, especially coming as it does at the end of the play. It's unprecedented in any of the other earlier versions that we have, though again, we do not have this so-called or Hamlet or early Hamlet by Thomas Kidd. Maybe it happens there. But in none of the sources is there any indication of anything like this. And I'd like to stress its peculiarity. From the very beginning of the play and all throughout it, the premise is that Denmark is trying to stay free of Norwegian domination. Indeed, the great credit that goes to the elder Hamlet is the triumph over the elder Fortinbras and won lands for Denmark. No matter what else you say about Claudius, he is pursuing a diplomatic path to try to keep Denmark safe. We certainly hear a lot in the opening scene about the military preparations in Denmark against a Norwegian invasion. Everything seems to be premised on the idea that, you know, here's Denmark and there's Norway, and you're trying to contain the threat of Fortinbras. And Hamlet, with his last gesture, this is top of page 143, Act 5, Scene 2, about line 355. But I do prophesy the election lights on Fortinbras. He has my dying voice. Now, I don't think this is just a stick it to Denmark gesture. That he's dying to say, well, what's the most awful thing I could do to these Danes. I'll give him a Norwegian as a king. We've seen him speak in praise of Fortinbras in Act 4, and he seems genuinely to admire him, you could call this a very philosophic gesture on the part of Hamlet, that he's indifferent to the ordinary consideration of friend and enemy. He's just looking around the world. Who's the best ruler for Denmark? So it's a Norwegian. That shouldn't matter. Now, again, try to explain that to people in ordinary political circumstances. You know, someone suddenly suggesting, well, Putin, he seems to be running a large country. Why don't we have him as the American president? We balk at ideas like that. At a certain point, you know, you come down to some kind of patriotic feeling. You want your ruler to be from your own country. Hey, it's even in our Constitution. But here, Hamlet ends by giving a Norwegian his vote for the Danish throne. And essentially, there's a very odd document, which is a bastardized version of Hamlet in German. It's called Der bestrafte Brudermord, the punished brother murder. And no one knows quite what it is. It is Hamlet and it's not Hamlet. It seems to be a traveling version of Hamlet that made it to Germany, perhaps based on an earlier text of the play. Again, you read it and you see, well, this is the basic story of Hamlet. Anyway, it's interesting. At this moment in the play, Hamlet says, I give my voice to my cousin, Fortinbras. There's at least a certain logic there. That somehow he's related, and royal lines often do get interrelated that way. It's as if whoever produced that version sensed something was missing in Shakespeare's text at this point. You know, why is Hamlet naming Fortinbras here? Well, let's at least make him a relative of Fortinbras. And again, for all we know, that some people think this German play relates to the earlier Hamlet. It's maybe the kid play translated to German. It would suggest maybe this gesture is there in the earlier play. But it does tell us an awful lot about Hamlet and opens up this question for us, would he have been a good king? He's so indifferent to Denmark and to Danish things. He has such contempt for Danish customs. We saw that last time. He doesn't like the drinking customs of Denmark. Again and again in the play, Hamlet speaks negatively of custom. Look at page 87. This is Act 3, Scene 4, about line 38. If damned custom have not braised it so. So custom is damned there. Or just a little later, page 92, Act 3, Scene 4, about line 163, actually beginning on the preceding page. Assume a virtue if you have it not. That monster custom, who all sense doth eat of habits devil, is angel yet in this. So custom is damned. It's a monster for him. And again, this is very philosophical. And in some ways, Hamlet's disposition is philosophical. He doesn't accept the customs of his particular people. He questions them. But Shakespeare seems to be raising the issue of how philosophical a king could be. In Henry V, he offers a kind of philosopher king. I read you that passage about the theoretical and practical part of life and that Henry somehow combined them. But Shakespeare seems to be interrogating that possibility in this play and wondering whether Hamlet's disposition fits the rule of a king. Now, that disposition is also very Christian, and that's what I was trying to show you last time. And in the three plays we're now doing, Hamlet, Othello, Macbeth, I'm going to argue that Shakespeare really investigates the question of Christianity and politics. We've seen already problems that in Henry V, that the institutional power of the Catholic Church creates significant political problems because it's a rival to the state in very significant ways. And we saw that the fact that Christianity is a religion in favor of peace, can make problems for warrior monarchs who somehow must reconcile their Christianity with their aggressive foreign policy. And we saw how Henry V can handle that. But I think from this point on, Shakespeare investigates even more deeply the effects of Christianity on the soul, and indeed its creation of the soul in the modern sense, and how much that complicates human life and specifically politics. When I talk about politics in this course, I do so in the broadest possible sense, where political questions are the fundamental human questions. And I've been trying to suggest that for Shakespeare, people live under distinct regimes, and those regimes emphasize different sets of virtues and vices, and how people approach their world is rooted in that. So that there is no simple universal human condition in the world for Shakespeare. So that, for example, on this fundamental issue of suicide, the ancient Romans have such a different approach to the question of suicide than the modern Christians, and we'll see how much that figures in Hamlet. It means that Shakespeare characterizes his figures in terms of distinct set of beliefs. Again, it's very easy to get that confused with Shakespeare's beliefs, and I'm bracketing out that question. We have no direct access to what Shakespeare's beliefs were. We can see, though, the sets of beliefs he imputes to his characters. And Hamlet is a particularly rich example of the diversity of beliefs that Shakespeare shows. Hamlet is the deepest Christian in this play, just as we saw that Antonio is the deepest Christian and maybe the only Christian in Merchant of Venice. That is, look at Laertes. In Laertes' case, to cut his throat in the church, he would have no hesitation in an act of vengeance, at least he claims, to cut someone's throat in the church. Actually, we'll see that when push comes to shove and he faces Hamlet, Laertes, in fact, hesitates. Hamlet obviously does not feel disposed to cut people's throat in the church, because, as we'll see in some detail, in a little while when he finds Claudius praying, he can't kill him. Take Horatio. I've cited him many times as saying, I am more an antique Roman than a Dane. That suggests, I'm from a different regime. I have a different set of beliefs. And we see it in the play when Hamlet speaks to Horatio and praises him for being a Stoic, for not being passion slave, for being something very Roman. And then there are these curious details about Horatio. If you look at page 4, Act 1, Scene 1, this is page 4, about line 23, when Bernardo and Marcellus are talking about the ghost, Marcellus says, Horatio says 'tis but our fantasy and will not let belief take hold of him. There's something oddly skeptical about this figure, Horatio. And even more powerfully on page 9, Marcellus has this beautiful Christian speech here about our Savior's birth. This is still Act 1, Scene 1, about line 156. About the ghost, it faded on the crowing of the cock. Some say that ever against that season comes wherein our Savior's birth is celebrated, this bird of dawning singeth all night long. And then they say no spirit dare stir abroad, the nights are wholesome. Then no planet strike, no fairy takes, nor witch hath power to charm, so hallowed and so gracious is that time. And Horatio says, so I have heard, and do in part believe it. Now, I'd love to know what part Horatio doesn't believe in Marcellus's speech about our Savior's birth. Hamlet knows this. A very famous line, not sufficiently appreciated, in my view, page 34. So the end of Act 1, Act 1, Scene 5, about line 165. Horatio says, oh, day and night, but this is wondrous strange. And Hamlet says, and therefore as a stranger, give it welcome. There are more things in heaven and earth, Horatio, that are dreamt of in your philosophy. again suggests that Horatio may be more an antique Roman than we think, that he may not be a Christian. And Hamlet suggests it here. You know, you don't believe in this ghost. And there are more things in heaven and earth, Horatio, that are dreamt of in your philosophy. I've seen editors who try to treat your philosophy as a general term, you know, like anybody's philosophy, your philosophy. But I've always felt the emphasis is on your there, in your philosophy, as if Horatio has a different philosophy from Hamlet's. And Hamlet's is a deeply, deeply Christian philosophy. So that's what I was trying to show you last time, this split in Hamlet. In general, I'm trying to show you how deeply rooted Shakespeare is in what we call the Renaissance, and that in some ways the heart of his work is an examination of the complexity of the Renaissance. Again, this point I've been making again and again, that our own culture and civilization is deeply sedimented, and it does rest on a Christian reinterpretation of the Roman appropriation of Greek things, and Shakespeare is very aware of that texture, and he gives that awareness to Hamlet. Hamlet's an unusual character in Shakespeare for having such a rich understanding of the very worlds that Shakespeare probes. Again, what I've been showing you, Shakespeare's and his Roman plays is trying to revive the ancient world, the pagan world, the world of classical antiquity. And then in Antony and Cleopatra, he even shows how that world began to transform into the Christian world. And now I'm showing you how he explores that Christian world in plays like Hamlet, Othello, and Macbeth. But Hamlet has such an awareness of that range of human experience. As I tried to show you last time, there's a very strong classical side to Hamlet. He is himself a man of thumos. He has a great deal of ambition, competitiveness, aggressiveness. He admires figures from classical antiquity. When he thinks of his father, he images him, as I showed you last time, in classical terms. Indeed, Hamlet's whole sense of the world is that his father comes out of a kind of Homeric world, a world of epic heroes who fight it out openly in hand-to-hand combat. And Hamlet has a strong sense of living in a deeply diminished world, a world in which the currents of heroism have been gone awry. They have been deeply deformed for one reason or another. And so all the associations with Julius Caesar and with Hyperion and Hercules and so on, all those point to Hamlet's being inspirited by images of classical antiquity. And for him, that weighs on his task of revenge, which he deeply associates, again, with the classical world, the world of the Aeneid, which he has the player call up in a speech, the world of heroes who were charged with carrying out vengeance. And again, that's the world out of which the very Hamlet story arises, the world of Norse saga, which isn't exactly classical antiquity, but is pagan and based on the revenge ethic as well. But then, as I showed, there's all this stuff working against that in Hamlet, and it's all associated with his Christianity. That he is not willing to take the heroic world as seriously as the heroes do. That he sees other dimensions to life. One way that might register for us is page 81. Again, since we've already read Antony and Cleopatra, this is Act 3, Scene 2, when Hamlet suddenly has a vision of the clouds. Act 3, Scene 2, line 385, says to Polonius, "Do you see yonder cloud that's almost in shape of a camel? By the mass, and 'tis like a camel indeed. Methinks it is like a weasel. It is backed like a weasel, or like a whale, very like a whale." Remember that moment in Antony and Cleopatra, when the whole classical world began to dissolve and leave not a rack behind. When for Antony, he had a vision of the clouds, and the clouds are ever changing in their shapes. I spoke of that as an intimation of that new heaven, new earth that Antony divines. And now we are in the Christian world where we have these clouds where things keep dissolving. Hamlet just does not accept the surface of the world. If you look at page 13, his earliest speech, this is Act 1, Scene 2, when Gertrude asks him, line 75 in Act 1, Scene 2, why seems it so particular with thee? And Hamlet answers, seems, madam? Nay, it is. I know not seems. 'Tis not alone my inking cloak, good mother, nor customary suits of solemn black. Again, he always has it in for custom. Nor windy suspirations or forced breath, nor the fruitful river of the eye, nor the dejected havior of the visage, together with all forms, moods, shapes of grief that can denote me truly. These indeed seem, for they are actions that a man might play, but I have that within which passeth show, these but the trappings and the suits of woe. Again, that shows you how Hamlet's mind works. He sees the surface of things, and then he plunges into the depths of things. Showed you how he looks at the universe, and it's beautiful. Man is beautiful, but beneath it he sees the quintessence of dust. This is a man that can look at a beautiful woman and see the skull beneath it. This, I would argue, is one reason he has a hard time functioning in the political world. He is, in a way, charged with a fairly simple task, it seems, to right the wrongs in Denmark, but there are all these reasons why he can't take Denmark seriously. So I showed last time he thinks life is transitory and glory is transitory. He thinks the world is corrupt. And so all that Christian disposition makes it hard for him to undergo the task that the ghost has given him. And indeed, it's worth looking at the task to see how complicated it really is. Again, I've mentioned there are many revenge plays written at this time, some earlier than Hamlet, some later than Hamlet. None of them have such complicated conditions because normally a ghost shows up and says, kill so-and-so. So-and-so killed me. You're my son. It's your responsibility to kill so-and-so. But if you look at page 30, this is Act 1, Scene 5, about line 85. In fact, the ghost puts Hamlet in a real bind. It would be so easy just to tell him to kill Claudius. But in fact, he says, line 84, but howsoever thou pursues this act, taint not thy mind, nor let thy soul contrive against thy mother aught. Leave her to heaven and to those thorns in her bosom large to prick and sting her. So it is not, even in the ghost terms, absolute revenge. Hamlet has to go about it in some way that will not taint his mind or really taint his soul, because don't let your soul contrive anything against your mother. This is indeed that problem that Hamlet raises in the Now Shall I Drink Hot Blood speech when he's faced with task of killing, but he realizes he can't do anything to hurt his mother. From the very task, you see how complicated it is for Hamlet and why it engages all these different aspects of his view of the world. Now, I said it was going to be a course in politics. I didn't say it was going to be a course in geography. But let's do some geography here to try to show how complicated Hamlet's situation is. Because I think in these three plays we're doing at the end, Hamlet, Othello, and Macbeth, Shakespeare engages in a kind of symbolic geography that in a way maps out for us, literally, the issues in the play. So, Hamlet is in Denmark. He's the Prince of Denmark. And if you kind of map out the geographic places that are mentioned in the play, north of Denmark is Norway, and it's associated with Fortinbras. And Norway is associated with the heroic world, the epic world. It's where, it's the world where the elder Hamlet fought the elder Fortinbras. It's where Fortinbras emerges as this conquering hero, as the man who's devoted to warfare. There's a strong sense in the play that Norway represents an older, maybe more primitive and barbaric world, the world that Hamlet associates with epic heroism. And then to the south of Denmark, we learn of two places, Paris and Wittenberg. Paris is associated with Laertes, and Paris, then as now, is a city of fashion. It's very much presented as such in the play. It's where a young gallant at court like Laertes wants to go to. And we learn what goes on in Paris. You learn how to fence. In Norway, you learn how to use a battle axe. In Paris, you learn how to fence, and hopefully with a poisoned rapier. It's such a different world. It's so much more modern. They play tennis in Paris. It's very fun. There's a reference to tennis in Paris. Actually, if you want to get a sense of Paris, you know, just look at Polonius's advice to Rinaldo when he's sending him to spy on Laertes. And he talks about what young men do in Paris. It involves going to whorehouses, I might point out, but playing tennis, drinking a lot. And you really get the sense, you know, Paris is what has been ever since, the land of pleasure and fashion and young gentlemen. And then the other city mentioned is Wittenberg, the university, which is associated with Horatio and Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. And Wittenberg is strongly associated with Martin Luther and Protestantism. The Protestant Reformation began in Wittenberg, 1517. That's when Martin Luther nailed his 95 theses to a door at the University of Wittenberg. At the very least, it's a university. So again, a more modern world, a world of scholarship. And by, you know, Shakespeare's amazing. The conversations between Hamlet and Rosencrantz and Guildenstern are undergraduate bull sessions. And they all this playing with words, a dream is but a shadow of ambition, then is a dream. But I'm sure you guys get involved in conversations like that as well. It's just amazing that as early as 1601, Shakespeare knows how undergraduates talk and how they party. But anyway, I think you could add the notion that Shakespeare would have been aware that Wittenberg was famous by then as the city of the Protestant Reformation. So what I'm getting at is Norway is the past and Paris and Wittenberg are the future. Norway is the fringe of Europe. Paris and Wittenberg are, in effect, the heart of Europe. Denmark is a borderland. It's even a backwater. That's one of the interesting things about it. That you see, as we mentioned last time, that the youth of Denmark want to be somewhere else. It's not cool to be in Denmark. And even when the players show up, you would think, this troupe of players, you would think, oh, it's a chance to play the palace. You know, this is like a royal commission. But what they're saying is, you know, things are really bad in Copenhagen and we're stuck on a road trip here and what can we do? So we'll play Elsinore, you know, big deal. And Hamlet feels sorry for them that they've ended up. He says, how do you end up in Elsinore? Not welcome to the royal court, you guys have made it, but what's going wrong that you're ending up playing here in Denmark? And so there is this strange sense in the play that Denmark itself is a backwater on the fringes of Europe and caught between these two worlds, caught between a heroic world tied to the past, an epic world, in some ways the world of classical heroism, and a much more modern world, a world of fashion, a world of universities and the new Protestant Reformation. And this maps very well in that, as I was showing you last time, Hamlet, in a way, is caught between these choices and between Fortinbras and Laertes and Horatio. These are all alternate figures who, as I said, wouldn't have Hamlet's problems if Hamlet weren't such a comprehensive intellect and such a comprehensive soul. He wouldn't have the difficult choices he has. It's what makes his situation peculiarly tragic. Okay, let me pause here and say, any questions thus far? Okay, let me just go a little further now into Hamlet's Christianity and the issues it raises. It does make it much more difficult for him to pursue a single-minded political path. One way we see this is his view of human corruption. Again, it's something that undermines his willingness to stand up for anything because he sees so much corruption in human life that he feels anything he achieves would be undermined. This particularly surfaces in his view of women, which is new to us in what we've seen in Shakespeare, and that is his sense that women are profoundly corrupt. And I'm going to say that this comes out of his Christian attitudes and his sense of human sinfulness and even original sin. This certainly comes out in his treatment of Ophelia and in his treatment of Gertrude. If you turn to page 65, so Act 3, Scene 1, this really painful dialogue, painful for us to hear, between Hamlet and Ophelia. This is about line 103 in Act 3, Scene 1. Ha ha! Are you honest? My lord, are you fair? What means your lordship? That if you be honest and fair, your honesty should admit no discourse to your beauty. Could beauty, my lord, have better commerce than with honesty? Aye, truly. For the power of beauty will sooner transform honesty from what it is to a bawd than the force of honesty can translate beauty into his likeness. This was sometime a paradox, but now the times gives it proof. I did love you once. Indeed, my lord, you made me believe so. You should not have believed me, for virtue cannot so inoculate our old stock, but we shall relish of it. I loved you not. I was the more deceived. Get thee to a nunnery. Why wouldst thou be a breeder of sinners? Now, as your note points out here, relish of it, smack of it, our old sinful nature. And this is Hamlet claiming that human beings, and specifically women, are sinful. They cannot truly be honest. And his recommendation is get thee to a nunnery. Now, we did not see this in the Roman plays as a recommendation, because there are no nunneries in the ancient world. We are now in the Christian world where there are nunneries, and we see here Hamlet's disposition for a kind of sexual purity that's embodied in the monastic ideal or the ideal of the nunnery. Now, as many people have pointed out, nunnery was a pun because it also meant house of prostitution in Elizabethan slang. So this get thee to a nunnery is a very double-edged claim. I think it both is get thee to a nunnery, withdraw from this world because it's sinful, and the only way to maintain your virtue is to maintain your sexual purity. But at the same time, and this is the crazy logic of the pun, he's saying get thee to a whorehouse. But what I'd like you to see is that the logic of this is fundamental to Hamlet. Women are either nuns or whores for him. There is no middle ground. That's indeed his problem with women, that he cannot combine in his mind sexuality with virtue. He thinks women have to be either entirely pure or they are simply full of vice. Now, undoubtedly, his experience of his mother's hasty remarriage has provoked this thought in his mind. But it is characteristic of him. There is a real all-or-nothing attitude in Hamlet. And I stress this because we're going to be seeing this in different ways in Othello and Macbeth as well. There's a kind of absolutism here. Now, you do not see this in the Roman plays. A part of their being said in a pagan world is that sexuality is precisely accepted as a natural part of life. And it is Christianity which introduces the idea of original sin and the sinfulness of sexuality, and it leads to a kind of radicalism with regard to marriage. In Hamlet, if you look at the next page, 66, line 136 in Act 3, scene 1, "If thou dost marry, I'll give thee this plague for thy dowry. Be thou as chaste as ice, as pure as snow, thou shalt not escape calumny." And indeed, that's his point. There is no true purity in the world. "Get thee to a nunnery. Go, farewell. Or if thou wilt need marry, marry a fool, for wise men know well enough what monsters you make of them. To a nunnery go, and quickly too. Farewell. Heavenly powers restore him. I have heard of your paintings well enough. God hath given you one face, and you make yourselves another." Again, that same obsession that came up in the gravedigger scene, that he looks at a woman and he sees them as painted. They have false faces. They're not true. You jig and amble and you lisp. You nickname God's creatures and make your wantonness your ignorance. Go to, I'll have no more on it. It hath made me mad. I say we will have no more marriage. Those that are married already, all but one shall live. And, you know, Claudius is overhearing this and he knows that's a reference to him. But no more marriage. Now, obviously, Christianity has been reconciled with human sexuality and the idea of sanctified marriage. That's Christianity's answer to this issue. If a man and a woman are married by the church, then they can engage in sex for the sake of procreation. Again, Christianity has to make some compromise with this world. But if you look at a lot of Christian theology, it regards marriage as the second best state. That celibacy is better, hence the whole monastic ideal, the nunnery ideal, very strong in the Christian Middle Ages, and Hamlet's disposed that way. And we're seeing something of the radicalness of a Christian attitude towards human nature here. Human nature is sinful, and that any form of sexuality is corrupting. And Hamlet just gets obsessed with that. It comes up in the play within the play scene in his little interchanges with Ophelia, bottom of page 73. So now Act 3, Scene 2, about line 157. "Is this a prologue or the poesy of a ring? 'Tis brief, my lord, as woman's love." And again, that sense of the transitoriness of values in human life, the most pressing example of that for Hamlet is a woman's love, because again, the thing that has most disillusioned him is his mother's remarriage. There's a lot of dirty puns in this scene. "It'll cost you a groany to take off my edge," country matters and stuff. I will not dwell on that. His scene with his mother, when he finally confronts her, this is particularly revealing of his obsessions with sexuality. You see it on page 89, for example, Act 3, Scene 4, about line 91, as you see him trying to imagine his mother in bed with Claudius. So line 92, "Nay, but to live in the rank sweat of an enseamed bed, stewed in corruption, honeying and making love over the nasty sty." And I want to dwell on how extreme this is. This is not the way Antony and Cleopatra talk about sex. Sex, for example, is definitely seen as corruption. Or page 92, one of the strangest passages. This is Act 3, Scene 4, about line 183. This strange negative, where instead of just saying, "Don't sleep with Claudius," Hamlet says, You know, when Queen says, "What shall I do?" he says, "Not this by no means that I bid you do. Let the bloat king tempt you again to bed, pinch wanton in your cheek, call you his mouse, and let him for a pair of reachy kisses or paddling in your neck with his damned fingers make you to ravel all this matter out." You know, in the act of denying the deed and arguing against it, he visualizes it in great detail. He's simply obsessed, not with sexual corruption simply, but with sexuality as corruption. Sexuality is in itself corruption. Again, page 91, same scene, about line 147. It will but skin and film the ulcerous place whilst rank corruption mining all within infects unseen. I can't stress enough how radical that vision is, how radical a vision of human corruption that is. It is so characteristic of Hamlet there that underneath the skin, it's just filming the ulcer. And what's at the heart of human life is rank corruption, mining all within, infecting unseen. This is a very unhealthy imagination. Remember, you know, when Hamlet picked up the skull in the graveyard and starts imagining it's Alexander the Great's skull, Horatio said, "Would be to consider too curiously to consider it so." Horatio, the ancient Roman, has a real sense that Hamlet's going over the top here. And I think it's this very, you know, a lot of people have attributed these views to Shakespeare, and I don't know how you can do that. This is just a character of Shakespeare's. But you sure as hell can attribute them to Hamlet, because that's what Shakespeare's doing. He's showing what an extreme view of human corruption would do to political life. Because I'm saying this is part of what unfits Hamlet, ultimately, I would say, for rule in Denmark, but even unfits him for this task of righting wrongs in Denmark. If you see human beings as so fundamentally corrupt, what's the problem with just Claudius then? He's just one example of a more thoroughgoing corruption. And Hamlet has, in a way, such a radical view of human life that would even banish marriage and send all women to nunneries to keep them pure. So wherever you look in Hamlet, you see the effects of his Christian beliefs. Here's in a way, a trivial but a very revealing example. Page 26, Act 1, Scene 4. When the ghost seems to be tempting him and Horatio is trying to stop him. So Act 1, Scene 4, about line 65. "Why, what should be the fear? I do not set my life at a pin's fee, and for my soul, what can it do to that, being a thing immortal as itself?" Very important that Hamlet sees the soul as immortal. Maybe Horatio doesn't, being an antique Roman. But notice the flip side of that is, "I do not set my life at a pin's fee." Here we get to the heart of what's problematic with Hamlet, that in light of his immortal soul, this life here and now becomes worthless. And that's the ultimate example of the all or nothing attitude in Hamlet, that he really does see this life in the light of eternity. Remember, we saw with the pagan Romans, their intense focus on politics follows from their blindness to an afterlife, since this place is the only place where you can achieve fame and glory, immortal glory. You have to strive for political action. I think we're seeing the other side, that same coin here in Hamlet. He is so rooted in visions of immortality that it's very hard for him to take this life seriously. And above all, this impinges on his task of killing Claudius. And that's what I want to dwell on for a bit now. Perhaps the most important scene for understanding Hamlet, page 85. So this is Act 3, Scene 3. To reset the scene for you, Claudius has been praying unsuccessfully, as it turns out, but Hamlet does not know that. He comes upon Claudius at prayer and has the opportunity to kill him and does not. We talked a bit about five-act structure in Shakespeare. This is the third act. This is the turning point of the play, and indeed this moment is indeed the turning point of the play. If Hamlet had killed Claudius at this moment, a lot would not have followed. Hamlet wouldn't be dead. Rosencrantz and Guildenstern wouldn't be dead. Polonius wouldn't be dead. Gertrude wouldn't be dead. Laertes wouldn't be dead. Horatio wouldn't be dead. Only Claudius would be dead. That it is, this is a key moment when Hamlet has a chance for the surgical strike. Just kill Claudius, and then everybody else wouldn't have had to die. And yet Hamlet doesn't do it, so this is a very important moment. The other thing I will point out is that this is the first moment when Hamlet knows virtually for sure that Claudius killed his father. Hamlet has himself expressed doubts in the ghost, considered the possibility that the ghost was a devil tempting him. He came up with the idea of the mousetrap play to test Claudius. He's put that plan into action. Claudius blenched. Claudius showed his guilt when he could not sit there and watch any more of the play. So in a way, everything's resolved for Hamlet here. This is the moment when he can do with good conscience what he's been considering doing. He, through Horatio, he would have some evidence of Claudius's guilt, and he does not do it. The question is why? And it's not, everyone says, you know, Hamlet's a mystery, and Shakespeare doesn't supply answers and so on. But it's a funny thing. Shakespeare gives us a pretty long speech here on page 85. Now might I do it, Pat. Now he is a praying, and now I'll do it. And so he goes to heaven, and so am I revenged. That would be scanned. A villain kills my father, and for that I, his sole son, do this same villain send to heaven. Why, this is hire and salary, not revenge. He took my father grossly, full of bread, with all his crimes broad blown as flush as May, and how his audit stands, who knows, save heaven. But in our circumstances and course of thought, 'tis heavy with him. And am I then revenged to take him in the purging of his soul when he is fit and seasoned for his passage? No. Up sword, and know thou a more horrid hent, when he is drunk, asleep, or in his rage, or in the incestuous pleasure of his bed at game of swearing, or about some act that has no relish of salvation in it, and then trip him, that his heels may kick at heaven, and that his soul may be as damned and black as hell whereto it goes. My mother stays, this physic but prolongs thy sickly days. Now, here we see how Hamlet's belief in an afterlife impinges on his duty here to his father, and we would say his political life. Because of his belief in an afterlife, he must take that into account in his action here. He must, in his own view, slay Claudius in a way that will send him to hell and not to heaven. I'll offer as a parallel Achilles and Hector. When Achilles goes to kill Hector, he does not worry about the state of Hector's soul. Being a pagan, all Achilles needs to do is kill the body and not worry about anything else. We see here how much more difficult the task of revenge is for a Christian, because it's a state of soul, not just a state of body. And indeed, Hamlet feels he's got to send Claudius to hell here. Now, a brief digression here, which I cannot resist. It is amazing to see the critical reaction to this scene, because every critic I know of goes into denial here that Shakespeare ever wrote these lines, and it goes all the way back to Samuel Johnson, the great 18th century critic and Shakespeare scholar who produced one of the best 18th century editions of Shakespeare. He said that these thoughts are too horrific to utter. Look, you've got the, if you've got the signet, turn to page 175, because you've got an excerpt from Samuel Taylor Coleridge, which both looks back to Samuel Johnson and adds, page 175 at the bottom is a good epitome of critical reaction to this scene. This is what Coleridge says of Johnson. This conduct and this sentiment Dr. Johnson has pronounced to be so atrocious and horrible as to be unfit to be put into the mouth of a human being, let alone Hamlet, our favorite character. The fact, however, is that Dr. Johnson did not understand the character of Hamlet and censured accordingly. The determination to allow the guilty king to escape at such a moment is only part of the indecision and irresoluteness of the hero. Hamlet seizes hold of a pretext for not acting when he might have acted so instantly and effectually. Therefore, he again defers the revenge he was bound to seek and declares his determination to accomplish it at some time when he is drunk asleep or in his rage or the incestuous pleasures of his bed. This, allow me to impress upon you most emphatically, was merely the excuse Hamlet made to himself for not taking advantage of this particular and favorable moment, far from doing justice upon his guilty uncle at the urgent instant of the spirit of his father. So we've got critics like Dr. Johnson who says, this is too horrible to utter. No human being would ever say this. And you'll even get critics saying, well, Hamlet would never say that, as if we somehow had a Hamlet independent of the one Shakespeare had created and who he gave these lines to. Coleridge's argument is a little more sophisticated. He's saying, well, this is just an excuse. It's Coleridge who came up with the view of Hamlet as the man who just thinks too much. His problem is he's too thoughtful, and that's why he can't act. And so Coleridge dismisses the content of Hamlet's thoughts. For him, the process of thinking here matters. Hamlet's just generating excuses. They are just excuses. They're not the real reasons. Now, I'd like to argue that these are the real reasons, that they are what Shakespeare gives us in the play. Incidentally, I said I watched Gamlet, the Russian version of Hamlet by Kosinsev. He just omits the whole speech. I was just stunned. I was watching the, how is Kosinsev going to handle it? Well, he found a fine way to handle the difficulty of speech. He just omitted it from the production entirely. And I think he was more honest. Most critics find a way to omit it in their consideration. But I don't think you can understand Hamlet unless you understand the speech. And you see how problematic revenge has become in the Christian world. Now, I oversimplified it in my initial formulation when I said the classical world, revenge is enjoined as part of the heroic ethic, and in Christianity, revenge is forbidden. Yes, that's true, but what we see here is a Christian revenge is going to be something more horrific than a classical revenge. The famous line which appears in the Old Testament and is repeated in the New Testament, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Well, that, of course, offers a divine prohibition against vengeance. However, at the same time, it offers a divine model of vengeance. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Vengeance is forbidden, and yet God can do it. And it's always, as Plato's Euthyphro shows, the question in piety is always, do you do what the gods say, or do you do what the gods do? And it's awfully tempting to imitate the gods rather than just listening to what they say. And so somebody, the Old Testament God holds up a quite remarkable example of vengeance to the nth generation, as it sometimes happens. And so in some ways, Hamlet has a model of vengeance, but the model is one of damnation. Again, far worse than the mere killing of the body that you see in the ancient world. And so if you really take this speech seriously, you see how difficult the act of revenge is. because, among other things, it requires knowledge of the soul. Line 82, and how his audit stands, who knows save heaven. I've seen critics who make the point here, oh, it's ironic. Claudius himself has admitted that his prayers are worthless, they're not working because he still is holding on to what he won. If Hamlet had killed him at this moment, Claudius would have gone to hell as Hamlet desired. But Hamlet cannot know that. And that's what's so deeply problematic here. It's an unusual scene. It's, in a way, the meeting of two soliloquies here. Claudius soliloquizing his prayer and Hamlet soliloquizing his decision not to kill Claudius. I will point out a very obvious fact about the play, the incredible proliferation of soliloquy now in this Christian world. I talked about the absence of soliloquy, the relative absence of soliloquy in Coriolanus, and the fact that when we do have soliloquies in the Roman plays, they tend to be more rhetorical than lyrical. We saw this with Brutus's It Must Be By His Death soliloquy, a soliloquy that begins with its conclusion and then searches for publicly defensible reasons that would lead to that conclusion. There's something almost frigid about the soliloquies in Coriolanus and Julius Caesar. They are not actually explorations of a mind in the process of reaching for a conclusion. They tend to be characters who've reached a conclusion and are trying to figure out how to present it publicly, so that even the private thought in Rome tends to be public, tends to take the public form of rhetoric. And I talked about how in Antony and Cleopatra, as I was saying, we begin to enter the world that was to become the Christian world, soliloquy, lyrical soliloquy, starts to appear. And now, in Hamlet, it's the great play of soliloquy, and not just Hamlet's soliloquies, but we get characters who are genuinely exploring themselves and thinking something through. When Hamlet begins the speech on page 85, he doesn't know yet what he's going to do. And he's actually working towards a conclusion, as is Claudius, for that matter, in his prayer, or Hamlet in all his other soliloquies. So we see a tremendous opening up of psychological interior in these plays. I think it's something that Shakespeare associates with Christianity, which makes his characters have so much more depth now. The Roman heroes, particularly someone like Coriolanus, you know, what you see is what you get. The greatness of Coriolanus manifests itself in deeds. You can see them on the battlefield, and it comes down to on fair ground. I could beat 40 of them. The greatness of characters like Hamlet, and we'll see something similar in Othello and Macbeth, is this richness of the interior that opens up as we start to explore the depths of their souls here. And so Hamlet really, you see how complicated his world has become. Again, I keep using the archetypal epic act of Achilles killing Hector. That is so simple in a way. You just stand up to Hector on the battlefield, and, you know, the great rule of epic warfare in Homer, you know, who's ever standing at the end, that's the epic hero. That's not so now in Hamlet's world. Things are so complicated because judging the situation requires knowing what's going on in people's minds. And this play is so filled with that. We see how much is concealed in this world, how much is in the dark in this world. The world of the Roman plays is a very sunlit world. The world where things happen out on battlefields and things are resolved clearly on battlefields. The world of Hamlet, and I'll add Othello and Macbeth, is such a dark world. It's a world where things are concealed and where the great quest is to find out what people are thinking. That comes up again and again in this play. We get, I'll talk about this some more next time when I talk about the specific court politics of the play, but, you know, Polonius spying on his own son, instructing Rinaldo in ways to extract the truth about about Laertes. Claudius and Polonius getting together to try to figure out what Hamlet really feels about Ophelia and staging that business, that interview, where they can listen from behind a curtain. There's so much listening from behind curtains in this work. Polonius ends up dead because of his propensity to listen from behind curtains when he tries it one time too many with Gertrude. Really the incredible scene with Hamlet and Ophelia, where he's trying to figure out her at the same time as she's trying to figure out him. We've got this plot, Polonius and Claudius trying to figure out if Hamlet's really in love with Ophelia. Hamlet trying to figure out if Ophelia's true with him. Turn to page 65. This is a famous moment in the staging. It's Act 3, Scene 1. This line, 131, where's your father? Brana does this well in his film. He has somebody make a noise, either Polonius or Claudius, so that Hamlet realizes they're spying on him. And if you do notice, Hamlet gets even nastier after that moment. Where's your father? When she says, at home, my lord, he realizes she's part of a plot against him. And then he gets really vicious with her. But again, that's the kind of world that Hamlet is in now, a world of intense spying into people's souls. And it has to do with the fact that soul has become so important now, the state of your soul. Now, there's, you know, soul comes from psuche, it's a Greek word for soul, but in the ancient world, the soul was kind of a shade that sort of accompanied the body and, on one hand, didn't seem to be capable of being all that detached from it. The full notion of soul, a mortal soul, separable from the body, saw that only gradually emerging at the end of Andy and Cleopatra. And here, in full flower in Hamlet, the world of an immortal soul with an infinite destiny and with everything hinging on that and people trying to figure out what's in the other guy's soul. It is, of course, a central problem in love in this play. It's, you know, Ophelia wondering, does Hamlet really love me? Hamlet wondering, does Ophelia really love me? People are just in quest here of finding out what's in each other's souls, and that is so difficult. As Hamlet himself again says in this scene, and how his audit stands, who knows, save heaven. We're going to see the difficulty of seeing into someone's soul is what destroys Othello when he gets his doubts about Desdemona. But this is a world of intense new doubts because things hinge on what's going on in your soul and what its future is. Now, this is the burden of Hamlet's most famous speech. To be or not to be, that is the question. This is a whole speech about the afterlife. It's on page 63 in our edition. So Act 3, Scene 1, about line 56. To be or not to be, that is the question. Whether it is nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against the sea of troubles and by opposing end them, to die, to sleep no more. And by a sleep to say we end the heartache and the thousand natural shocks that flesh is heir to, 'tis a consummation devoutly to be wished. That is the pagan option. The speech begins with the pagan option, that death is at most just sleep. You find that in Plato's Apology, when Socrates speaks about death. And some people have traced this speech to a passage in Cicero that goes back to Socrates. In some ways, Hamlet is saying the world would be so easy if it were a pagan world, where death just ended things. That would be a consummation devoutly do we wish. But to die, to sleep perchance to dream, aye, there's the rub. And that's the Christian option now that haunts him. And again, he is profoundly Christian, convinced of the immortality of his soul. For in that sleep of death, what dreams may come when we have shuffled off this mortal coil must give us pause. The whole problem is the afterlife, the Christian option. There's the respect that makes calamity of so long life. For who would bear the whips and scorns of time, the oppressor's wrong, the proud man's contumely, the pangs of despised love, the law's delay, the insolence of office, and the spurns that patient merit of the unworthy takes when he himself might his quietus make with a bare bodkin. Again, that was the Roman attitude toward suicide, which we saw in the Roman plays. Things get too bad, you lose your honor, threatened with the loss of dignity, you can always kill yourself. Who would fardels bear to grunt and sweat under a weary life, but that the dread of something after death, the undiscovered country from whose born no traveler returns, puzzles the will? Now, just parenthetically here, a lot of people have raised the question, how can Hamlet say this when he's just met the ghost of his father? How can he speak of the undiscovered country from whose born no traveler returns? He means returns alive. I mean, I think this is fair enough. I don't think this is a contradiction in Shakespeare here, that this, ghosts may come back, but you don't die and come back as a living being. Anyway, undiscovered country from was born, no traveler returns, puzzles the will, and makes us rather bear those ills we have than fly to others that we know not of. Thus conscience does make cowards of us all. And thus the native hue of resolution is sicklied o'er with the pale cast of thought, and enterprises of a great pitch and moment with this regard, their currents turn awry and lose the name of action. Now again, these are among the most famous words in the play, and yet I don't think people have sufficiently thought through what they're saying. Basically, this speech is about how thoughts of the afterlife distort our view of this life, and in particular, undermine any notion of heroism, and specifically any notion of ancient or classical heroism. Now, for example, this is the kind of passage that Coleridge points to when he says that Hamlet is a man who thinks too much. The Olivier movie begins, "This is the tragedy of a man who thinks too much," and that's a kind of reading of the line, "Thus conscience does make cowards of us all." But it's not just thinking in this speech. It's thinking about the afterlife. This is very specific in this speech. It's not just some abstract notion. Gee, if you think too much about life, you'll never get anything done. It's very carefully set up in the speech. Here's the pagan alternative. Here's the Christian alternative. And it's thinking about the afterlife that produces these effects. And enterprises of great pitch and moment, with this regard, their currents turn awry and lose the name of action. That notion of their currents turn awry, I mean, I think it's a central idea in this play, that these Christian notions of the afterlife turn awry the currents of heroism from the ancient world. This is all a play about distortions of heroism. Again, you have an image of classical or epic heroism in the elder Hamlet and the elder Fortinbras, an epic confrontation. By the end of the play, you've got this horrifically Machiavellian fencing match between Hamlet and Laertes with all these Borgia-like elements in it, poison rapiers, poison drinks. That's the turning awry that this play presents. How something that was once so noble gets distorted into this view, this corruption. Now, a lot of this, again, has to do with the issue of suicide. And this is a place, we'll get to Ophelia's suicide next time, but suicide is something that haunts this whole play, and it haunts it first and foremost in Hamlet's perspective, and it's indeed the first thing we hear from him, his complaints about the issue of suicide. Look at page 14, another one of these soliloquies. I mean, Shakespeare didn't waste these soliloquies. They all give us profound insights into Hamlet. So this is page 14, Act 1, Scene 2, about line 129. Oh, that this too sullied flesh would melt, thaw, and resolve itself into dew. Now, as your notes point out, in one of the editions of Hamlet, maybe if I have time next time, I'll explain a bit about the different texts of Hamlet, but in one of the texts, it's solid flesh. I much prefer solid flesh there. I think it should be, oh, that this too solid flesh would melt, thaw, and resolve itself into a dew. I like that because the melt seems to go along with solid. The image of solid flesh melting into dew seems to be more powerful. But I'll live with sullied if an editor wants it, because that's also the Christian idea then of original sin, sullied flesh. Anyway, oh, that this too solid flesh would melt, thaw, and resolve itself, or that the everlasting had not fixed his canon against self-slaughter. I mean, that's the first thing Hamlet complains about in the play, is the Christian prohibition against suicide. Again, we saw that moment in Antony and Cleopatra, when Cleopatra, for the first time, says, is it sin to steal into the secret house of death? The emergence of the prohibition against suicide with the emergence of at least proto-Christian ideas in that play. Here we are in full mode here that Hamlet cannot commit suicide because it's against the Christian religion. And it's quite revealing that Hamlet refers to God here as the everlasting. What you see throughout Hamlet is a sense of the difference between the everlasting and the merely transitory. Again, he looks at this whole world, and that includes politics, in light of the everlasting. And that's his fundamental critique. It's why he says 'tis paltry to be Caesar. That politics is not the realm of the everlasting. Hamlet's father's reputation lasted 2 months. So how good is that? He wants the everlasting. And then you see, you know, his view of the world. Oh, God, God, how weary, stale, flat, and unprofitable seem to me all the uses of this world. Fie on it, a fie, 'tis an unweeded garden that grows to seed. Things rank and gross in nature possess it merely. Again, this is not Coriolanus's view of the world. It's not Brutus's view of the world. It's not Julius Caesar's view of the world. It isn't Antony and Cleopatra's view of the world, that it's so rotten. This is the sort of thing you would expect to hear in a medieval sermon rather than in a Roman play. This play is filled with the gravedigger scene especially, with a kind of medieval image of human life, just skull after skull. And then you see what provokes these thoughts. In particular, it is the marriage of his mother, the remarriage, that it should come to this, but 2 months dead, nay, not so much, not two, so excellent a king that was to this Hyperion, to a satyr, so loving to my mother that he might not beteem the winds of heaven, visit her face too roughly. Heaven and earth, must I remember, why she would hang on him as if increase of appetite had grown by what it fed on, and yet within a month, let me not think on it, frailty, thy name is woman, a little month, or ere those shoes were old, with which she followed my poor father's body like Niobe, all tears, why she a god, a beast that wants discourse of reason, would have mourned longer, married with my uncle, my father's brother. So this is his primary image of the transitoriness of glory, that his mother betrayed his father's memory. Again, the focus on women's corruption here, again, very much in line with especially medieval Christianity. And so you see his problem here. In some ways, his central problem in this play is that he can't commit suicide. I'll argue next time that he finds a way of indirectly committing suicide. But this is what leaves him incapable of accomplishing his task in this play. It's why he ends up reacting to things rather than being the active force. It's interesting. He even comes to abjure his own responsibility in the course of the play with, you see it on page 138, when he's trying to be reconciled with Laertes, and so he does try to make apologies for that scene at the grave, and this is Act 5, Scene 2, about line 234. Was it Hamlet wrong, Laertes? Never Hamlet. If Hamlet from himself be ta'en away, and when he's not himself does wrong Laertes, then Hamlet does it not. Hamlet denies it. Who does it then? His madness. This is actually a dangerous moral evasiveness in Hamlet, that he ultimately does not claim responsibility for what he does. It is that passivity we saw emerge in the course of the Roman plays, that sense that people began to doubt whether they had control of their destiny. And that's very strong in Hamlet. This is page 137. It's Act 5, Scene 2. This is line 220, again on page 137. This is when, we'll talk about this more next time, but when Horatio is afraid that Hamlet's getting himself in trouble by getting involved in a fencing match with his bitter enemy Laertes, Hamlet says, "Not a whit, we defy augury." That's interesting, I'd never noticed that before. We defy the Roman approach. That's so perfect. I had never saw that before. But augury, which is so important in the Roman plays, that's what the ancients relied on, was augury. There's a special providence of the fall of a sparrow. That's Christianity. Notion of special providence. You have an omnipotent, omniscient God. The idea, there's a special providence in the fall of a sparrow, means God sees everything. He takes care of everything. This is what the omnipotent, omniscient God of Christianity can do and that the pagan gods cannot do. If a sparrow... it's quoting Matthew 10:29. Thank you, Mr. Editor. Are not two sparrows sold for a farthing, and one of them shall not fall on the ground without your Father? What an amazing claim. About a divinity that cares about everything. So if it be now, 'tis not to come. If it be not to come, it will be now. If it be not now, yet it will come. The readiness at all, since no man of aught he leaves knows what is it to leave betimes. Now this is often offered by some critics as a very positive speech. There are people who talk about a change in Hamlet in Act 5, that he's grown more mature, that this speech shows that he's now reconciled to his fate. I think, though, he's reconciled in a very negative way. It is now a kind of fatalism. Again, we trace that in the Roman plays. From the Republican attitude, men are the masters of their fate. The fault of Brutus is not in our stars, but ourselves. To this sense, oh, this day is going to come out the way it will come out, and I can't do anything. This is really problematic, what Hamlet says now. If it be not now, 'tis not to come. Be not to come, will be now. If it be not now, yet will come. The readiness is all. The readiness here is simply passivity. It's letting Claudius take the initiative, it turns out. It's just responding to your enemy's actions, not taking the active role itself. And so it's another aspect of his Christian worldview now, that he's come to, that all throughout he believes that the world is ordered by a special providence, and so why does he have to take the initiative? He can just go with the flow. This proves to be disastrous in this final scene. And that's what we'll do next time. We'll look at more at the issue of suicide in connection with Ophelia, but also look at the way Hamlet finally finds a way of committing suicide without actually having to do it or appear to take an active role in that. Okay, that's it for today then.